Thanks, Rajni. I enjoy these things that Giant puts on every year. Unlike a lot of conferences that I speak at, I'm really pleased and proud, and I'm not at all embarrassed to be here with the other speakers, which is often the case in other venues. And I agree with everything I've heard today. My good friend Rick Rule was wrong in one important regard. He says that he's not a philosopher.
Would the children of today's...
I'd like to ask a question. I have some bad vibes the way the world... And he spoke wisely. So he is a philosopher. And he is an economist, because what is an economist? Certainly not Paul Krugman. It's an economist can be defined as someone who accurately describes the way the world works, not prescribes the way they think the world ought to work, and then whisper it in the ears of politicians to enforce it. So, the way I typically like to start a presentation to especially a libertarian audience is I like to ask a question. I have some bad news for you. There's a federal agent from a nasty agency that's been planted here to monitor this, to perhaps to be helpful to round up the usual suspects when the time comes. So to save yourself embarrassment, I know where you are, I know who you are, I ask you politely, please stand up and identify yourself at this point, would you? I'll wait. Oh, good. Okay. I've been doing that ever since I gave a speech in the Cayman Islands with a lot of really dodgy types about 15 years ago or so. And just as a goof, I mean, this was just a comic ploy. And I asked that question, and I swear this is the truth. Not one, but two people stood up. And I think it was because a cop has to identify himself if you ask him. Two people stood up. So I thought that was quite amazing. Okay. Another thing I always like to do when I'm not in the United States, I don't dare do this anymore in the United States, is I like to tell a little joke. And people often ask me, Mr. Casey, who are you to give financial advice? I mean, you've never even had a real job your whole life. How come it is you've never ever had a real job? And I always say, well, you know, on those employment application forms they have you fill out, and they ask you, do you advocate the overthrow of the U.S. government by force or violence? Well, I always check violence. Anyway, as Rajni mentioned, I shouldn't even mention America, because America is dead. America is an idea. It was an excellent idea. It was a unique idea, but it's dead. I call it the United States now. I don't even call it these United States, which incidentally, when people spoke of the United States, even 50 years ago, certainly 100 years ago, they didn't say the United States, they said these United States, which that issue was solved finally during the War of Northern Aggression from 1861 to 65. So it's an entity, and it's not a composition of individual places. But starting out talking about the U.S., the subject of my presentation, incidentally, is going to be on the nature of evil and stupidity. These are two twins, actually, that are often mistaken for each other. And most of what I'm going to talk about is going to be about evil and stupidity, what they are, and how they're often confused with each other. But talking a little bit more about America first, some of you guys are going to remember this. Back in the 50s and the 60s, when we were kids, and maybe when one kid would be razzing about something or whatever, getting risque or a little out of control, he'd say, hey, It's a free country. And you notice how nobody says that anymore? That phrase is passed out of existence. So this is some rare intellectual honesty on the part of the average chimpanzee out there who doesn't really figure out why he doesn't use that anymore. And even during the 70s, there was something during the Vietnam War they used to say, yeah, America's never going to have concentration camps. We'll call them something else. And it turned out we do. We don't call Guantanamo a concentration camp. So the U.S., and to a lesser degree, but a great degree, Canada, used to be a place where you could do anything that you wanted to do, as long as you didn't hurt anybody else. And anything that, now almost everything that's not obligatory is actually prohibited. And I like to sort some examples out. You know, they got these signs everywhere. They got no running, no jumping, no swimming, no diving, no fishing, no hunting, no talking, no swearing, no sassing, especially if you're talking to a government agent, you better be respectful. There's no juking, no jiving, no socializing, blowing dope, snorting coke, practicing your stroke. I mean, you're not supposed to do anything. There's no sex, no drugs, no violence, except by the state. There's no alcohol, no tobacco, no firearms. They even got an agency to regulate the few things you need for a camping expedition or a halfway decent party. Of course, there's no smoking. And especially in this city, the smoke Nazis have taken over. And normally at this time I would light up a cigarette. I far prefer cigars to cigarettes, but I wouldn't dare here a cigarette, because I lit up a cigar in our office. We used to have an office next to it was in the RBC building actually on Hastings Street. And so at the end of a day I opened a window, sat next to the window, had a smoke, and this is the truth. After I left the office, about an hour later, somebody thought they smelled cigar smoke, and they called whatever Vancouver authority. They came in. There was no evidence of a cigar, but he sniffed. He made the determination that a cigar had been smoked, and they fined us $1,500. I kid you not. That's the truth. And that was a couple years ago here in Vancouver, so I'm not going to wear that book. As much as I'd like to after lunch.
Could you have smoked on the street?
Yes, if I smoked more than 10 feet from the building, as you know, here in Vancouver. But a cigar is a contemplative experience. You can't stand on a street corner and smoke a cigar. It's not the way it works. So now you've got a, you know, if you're very daring, and the only time you can have a cigarette in the city is maybe after sex or maybe before you're going to be executed. But that's about it. And when I do smoke a cigarette, I prefer American spirits. Any of you that saw that movie with who's Goldie Hawn's other? Kurt Russell, right, where he played Snake Plissken. And I thought it was a great scene. We're at the end of Escape from L.A. He's smoking an American cigarette. I thought that was a well-done movie in many ways. But anyway, everybody's gotten used to doing what they're told. And the trouble with libertarians is that we do what we're told, too. There's a lot of good reasons for that. You don't want to get thrown in jail. You don't want to get in trouble. It's inconvenient and so forth. But let's admit it. We're all a bunch of whipped dogs, and we act like it. And if circumstances are right, we're not just whipped dogs. We roll over on our backs and wet ourselves. It's really degrading. And a lot of people think I got a problem with authority. That's not true. I just don't like other people telling me what to do. But it's all very much out of control. But I see whipped dogs everywhere. I especially see whipped dogs when you go through an airport, especially in the U.S. It's the worst now. But everywhere. or when people go through customs. They always smile. Look at what you do when you go through customs, immigration at an airport. The guy takes your passport. People smile ingratiatingly. They make supplicating motions. They grovel. This disgusting, petty official. My God, if you do that, if you act like that to one of these worms, then you deserve the world that you're living in today. So I just wanted to draw that to your attention, because a lot of you probably just do that responsibly, reflexively. Don't do that. I never do. So why do people do that? I would say that it's a matter of psychology, which is a good measure of what I want to talk about here today. And it has to do with an acceptance of collectivism. And that's the real problem in the world today. It's the philosophical acceptance of collectivism. And I'd point out to you that collectivism and statism are not intellectual problems. This is one of the problems with the libertarian movement. We're very intellectually oriented. It's why, for instance, 90% of this group are males, because males, for some reason, tend to look at things from an intellectual point of view, but women tend to look at things more from a psychological point of view. It's just in the genes, it's the way we're programmed by an accident of birth. And I'd point out to you that this is one of the reasons why libertarians are not terribly successful in propagating our philosophy, because we appeal to the intellectual. But the problem is not intellectual. It's easy to explain these things, why statism is stupid and counterproductive. It's really a psychological or even a spiritual problem. That is the nub of the issue, not intellectual. It's a spiritual aberration. So I want to look at some individuals that perhaps characterize the problems. One of my recent bete noirs was the last, not the current, but the last vice president of the U.S., Dick Cheney. And this guy it was a genuine sociopath, an actual criminal. And you could sit down and talk to him about these principles, and he could intellectually comprehend them, because when it comes to passing an IQ test, I would think that he's at least at 110 level anyway. He could understand that, but it would never sink in. The chances of your changing of his attitudes would be slim and none, and Slim's out of town, so you can forget about that. Now, why is that? It's not because he's stupid. It's not because he can't understand. It's because he's a sociopath. It's because it's his nature. And I can substitute hundreds of names that you all know for Cheney. It's just that he's a really glowing example, in my opinion. The guy has no conscience, and he's susceptible to intellectual arguments against a police state to about the same degree a cat can be convinced that he shouldn't torture a mouse before he kills it. They're cold, these sociopaths. They're unemotional. They're like reptiles, even though they look like people. And I'm going to build a case that they may not even be human beings. And you may think I'm kidding, but I'm not kidding, because we all know that power corrupts. But I think it's more important to realize that the corrupt seek power. It's not just power that corrupts, it's the corrupt that actually go to seek power. It's the sociopaths that actually go to seek power. And that's because you've got two basic types of people. There's lots of ways of dividing people. But from a moral, ethical point of view, let me choose this one. You've got people that are interested in controlling the material universe, controlling the world. Scientists, engineers like to manipulate things, build things, and so forth. Okay, that's wonderful. That's one of the mainsprings of human progress. Then you've got other kinds of people. They are not interested so much in that. They're in manipulating material reality. They're interested in manipulating other people. And that's one good way, a good fingerprint of a sociopath. So those are the two types of people. And guess which type inevitably is drawn to government, which is pure congealed power and coercion, forcible manipulation of other people. So I would make the case that sociopaths are inevitably drawn to government. And also, big corporations, which are hooked up with government, and the media, which is hooked up with all these things, tend to manipulate people. That's what they do for a living. So let me get deeper into the subjects of stupidity and evil, and which is which, and if you're dealing with somebody that's not quite right, how can you tell if it's a knave or a fool that you're dealing with? Let me cover stupidity first. Some of you are probably thinking, sure, I can see that Dick Cheney was a sociopath, but what about Bush, who was the president at the time? You all remember him. And you're thinking, he's more of a fool than a knave. Pity the poor fool. Isn't it a mistake to accuse somebody of malevolence when Occam's razor might indicate that stupidity is a more likely example or answer for doing the wrong thing? And I've thought about it, actually. And stupidity can account for a lot of things in the world. I mean, as Einstein famously said, after hydrogen, the most common thing in the universe is stupidity. So, I mean, you got to give people the benefit of the doubt based on that for stupidity as opposed to malevolence. But as with all these things, I like to define the words, because stupidity is a word that's often used, and it's usually used as a pejorative. And perversely, when it's used as a pejorative, it's often used by stupid people who call other people stupid and never define the word. So I want to try to do that. It's important to define words precisely, because unless you define words precisely, then how can you be sure you even know what you're talking about, or how can you be sure that other people are defining the word the same way, and then you're at cross purposes and you can't possibly communicate with each other? Most of the time, people use stupidity as a synonym for low intelligence. And that's accurate, of course, but it doesn't really tell us anything we don't already know. And of course, when you look at how stupid the average person is, and then you figure that half of the people are more stupid than average, I mean, we're really in trouble at that point. Going back to the baby Bush, who I think is like a poster child for all this, I've always said that he was stupid. Technically speaking, I think he's actually a moron. Now, stupidity comes in flavors, and I want to get into this for a moment because it's actually quite important. Most people don't know that a moron, an imbecile, and an idiot, although these words are used interchangeably, they're actually clinically defined. They're not at all the same thing. An imbecile is somebody who can get by in society, walk down the street, get by, needs a little bit of assistance, but he can get by in the real world. An idiot is somebody whose intelligence is so low, he really has to be institutionalized. It's very problematic. A moron, though, is much more interesting, because a moron can conduct himself in day-to-day society just like any other human being. He can talk about the weather, the state of the roads, can talk about sports, TV sitcoms, or in the case of Bush, he can talk about the economy, the wars, and he can seem more or less normal. But my guess is that Bush has an actual IQ of about 85, and that would be about the average for a moron. Just somewhat below the average. And I think I can prove this to you by giving you some examples. Let's talk about the current candidate for the Republicans. The Republicans are the stupid party, the Democrats are the evil party. I want to go into that a little bit more. You have the equivalent of that in Canada. to. Romney appears to be stupid. I'm not sure if he's anywhere near as stupid as Bush, but he appears to be. One good definition of stupidity, and I think you'll like this. Stupidity is an unwitting tendency to self-destruction. That's why comics that do stupid things like slapstick, stumble, and all that, it's an unwitting tendency to self-destruction. So I like that definition of stupidity. And I'll give you another definition, which I think is quite good. It's an inability to correlate cause and effect. That's much more helpful than saying that somebody has low intelligence if they're stupid. It's an inability to correlate cause and effect. That's what makes people look stupid. So look at those two definitions, or if you wish, an inability to predict accurately the consequences of actions. And I'd suggest to you that when you look at Bush, who's, like I said, a poster child of stupid, like Cheney was a poster child of evil, his entire life, he seems to fit that definition to a T. A good definition of an economist, maybe one, as I'm referring to this, but there are some others that are worthwhile knowing when you think about an economist. It's not somebody that has a PhD from a university. An economist is somebody that can see not only the immediate and direct consequences of actions, but the indirect and delayed consequences of actions. Now, even a moron can, not an idiot, but a moron can almost always see the immediate and direct consequences of an action, but he can't see the indirect and delayed ones. That's what makes him look stupid. So that would seem to indicate that not only Bush is a moron, but the average American voter who voted for him, because they usually vote for somebody that's marginally more intelligent than they are, if Bush is a moron, then the people voting for him must actually be imbeciles, because they vote for somebody like a standard deviation above their own level. So this guarantees, in my opinion, a sad future for the U.S. But let me go into this a little bit further still. Stupidity is only a partial explanation of these people. Let's look at better-known sociopaths that are inevitably drawn to governments and wind up controlling them. They wind up controlling governments when the bigger government gets, the more attractive it is to sociopaths, and the higher percentage of people that are sociopaths work for the government. Early in the founding of any country, when the government is small and relatively benign, and you know, maybe some people of goodwill try to fund things, it's not the greatest environment for sociopaths, better than society at large, but not the greatest. But as it gets bigger and gets more out of control, they're inevitably drawn to it. I would say that criminals, even criminal geniuses, are basically stupid, according to the definitions that I've just given you. And let's take Hitler. People say, well, Hitler was a criminal genius. Well, yeah, I suppose that's true from one point of view, but then you have to look at their actions. You have to be objective about this type of thing. I'm very anti-Christian, but nonetheless, Jesus of Nazareth said wise things. That's one of the reasons why St. Paul's religion was roughly built on Jesus. I don't know how they did that. Became so popular because they're gems of wisdom. And one of the gems was, by their fruits you shall know them. So how stupid was it to attack Russia when you still had an open front in the West with the British? How stupid was it to throw the Sixth Army at Stalingrad? There are probably 50 things from World War II that I could give you that show the stupidity of Hitler. Well, how about Stalin? Maybe he was a genius since he was able to beat Hitler, but I'd say that he was a sociopath, and like all sociopaths, he was actually stupid. Not just evil, but stupid. How stupid was it to starve millions of kulak farmers in the 30s when the country was already starving? How stupid was it just before when Hitler was building up to execute hundreds of thousands of experienced and well-trained officers and higher NCOs in the Red Army just before World War II? He was constantly doing stupid things, but you know, the 30s and 40s is the era, the last era, the previous era. With sociopathy and evil and stupidity ruled the world. Look at Roosevelt. Americans look at him as being a genius to save the economy from the Great Depression. Of course, that's an incredible lie and inaccurate. How stupid was it for him to pour milk in the gutter when people were starving because of his actions, slaughtering livestock when people were starving because of his actions, making it worse, burdening the economy with taxes and regulations at the bottom of the Depression and so forth. So I don't need to catalog all these stupidities by political leaders. You guys all know that, it's the intellectual stuff. But here's the point I want to make. Political leaders are almost invariably stupid about actual reality. What they're not stupid about is manipulating people. Getting back to what I said about the two types of people, manipulating reality and manipulating other people. So that's where people get confused. They're geniuses at the one, manipulating people, but very stupid about reality. Now, let me talk a little bit about evil, having talked a little bit about stupidity, because they are like fraternal twins, actually. And I'd like to suggest that what differentiates political elites from other people is a capacity for evil. So what's evil? Evil is the intentional commission of acts that are cruel or unjust. I think that's a good definition of evil. It's not what Holy Mother in the Church says or anything like that. She doesn't use that definition. So I'd like to suggest that political elites are almost exclusively and necessarily composed of sociopaths. And it's not that they just aren't normal human beings. I'll go back to what I said before. I'd say that they're barely even human. Now, how can I say that? It's a radical kind of statement, very politically incorrect, and gets you into a lot of trouble, and a slippery slope. Well, I would say it has nothing to do with who somebody is, where they're born, none of that stuff. That's all completely trivial and pointless and meaningless. It has to do with the way people act. And I could give you about a dozen really interesting tip-offs to where you're dealing with a sociopath, but I picked four of them that I think are perhaps outstanding. First one is that they completely lack a conscience or any real regret for hurting people, although they always pretend the opposite. And they think that they were just the sweetest and most loving people in the world, just the opposite. Pathological liars also. Second thing, in addition to not having a conscience, is they always put their own desires and wants on a totally different level from those of other people. They truly believe that the end justifies the means, although they always pretend the opposite, because they're liars. Three, they consider themselves superior to everybody else because they aren't burdened by these emotions and ethics that other people might be burdened by. That makes them extremely arrogant, although they pretend the opposite because they're liars. And fourth, they never accept the slightest responsibility for anything that goes wrong, even though they're largely responsible for almost everything that goes wrong. So these are identifying points of a sociopath. And above all, they're chronic, extremely convincing, and enthusiastic liars. And that means that they're not easy to spot because they don't look like a whiply snidelash with a mustache and all this type of thing. And their skill at cultivating a social veneer so that when you first meet them, very hard to dig through that social veneer, that mask of sanity that they wear over their face, that misdirects suspicion away from them. That's why in a good murder mystery, you at least initially never suspect the guy that actually did it. It's always the guy you don't suspect, it seems. So real humans have a conscience. They feel genuine remorse if they do something wrong. This is kind of interesting to me that in the so-called criminal justice system, the judge always wants to guy to show remorse. That's usually just a bullshit act and all that. I mean, of course he's going to show remorse because he knows that's what the judge wants, but it's rarely sincere. On the contrary, they're actually apologizing. So you may be thinking that what happened in Nazi Germany, Soviet Union, Mao's China, Pol Pot's Cambodia, and scores of other countries can't happen in the U.S., or for that matter, can't happen in Canada for some reason. But let me posit that the proportion of sociopaths here in society, or and among the 7 billion people on the face of the planet, is constant, I think, across space and time. I'm mainly a believer in nature as opposed to nurture. I mean, it's an interesting separate discussion. But I think that the population of sociopaths is pretty constant across space and time. Only at sometimes when conditions are right do they evidence themselves. It's like mushrooms after a rainstorm. You don't know they're there until after it rains and they blossom. And I'm suggesting that we're having a rainstorm now. Well, I'll give you one piece of evidence for that. We got, in the United States, we've got about 60,000 or so people that are working for the TSA. And my question is this. Where did they find 60,000 generally middle-aged people to go and put on a costume and act in a degraded way by and degrade other people? What kind of a human being would do that? They must have been doing something else before. That's a heavy population of sociopaths among the TSA. And the creation of an organization like the TSA has drawn them out from under the rocks, much the way the creation of the Gestapo or the Stasi or the NKVD or any of these hundreds of organizations across time and space always drew out those sociopaths that maybe they liked kids, they liked dogs, Hitler liked kids and dogs, they liked to play baseball on the weekends, but when they see that opportunity, oh, TSA, extra couple dollars an hour and benefits, they're drawn to that and they start reinforcing themselves. And if there's any decent human beings working in a criminal organization like that, they're eventually driven out and the whole organization becomes corrupt from top to bottom. So these things get worse. They don't get better. They necessarily get worse for just that reason. Now part of this is also an expression of Pareto's law. I'm sure you are all somewhat familiar with that. It's the 80-20 rule. 20% of your salesmen do 80% of the selling. 80% of the crime in society is by 20% of the people. That 80-20 rule is actually quite accurate. It works everywhere. The application of it I would use here is that my opinion is that 80% of human beings are basically decent. They're not libertarians, but they're basically decent, get along, go along. Okay? That's why society kind of hangs together the way it is. But out of that 20%, those people might be called potential trouble sources. And 20% of that 20% are actual bad apples. They're actual criminal personalities. They're actual sociopaths. Then you take 20% of that 20%, and you're dealing with really bad actors, really dangerous people. And I think that they're coming to the fore at this point. Now, why does the average person accept this situation, these criminal organizations that are now coming to the fore, not just in the US, not just in Canada, but all over the world? Governments are under control. It's true everywhere in the world today. They're all going on the rampage. I can give you two reasons for this. One is that the average person has no philosophical anchor. I mean, really, he's never actually thought, no way he's ever listened to any of Stefan's shows. He's never thought about, you know, the implications of what's actual right and wrong. He believes what he just hears, or some teacher. So that's, I'd say that's the number one thing. So they don't even have. And as I pointed out, the problem isn't even intellectual. It's spiritual and psychological. But they don't even have the intellectual grounding to start with. And the second reason, certainly referring to America, is the whole country has become a nation of limp dicks. It's, I'm so tired of hearing this blather about the land of the free and the home of the brave and support our brave troops and all this. It's all so much bullshit. All right, so what's going to happen now? I think that sociopathy, because these organizations have been created, the government has become virulent, the average person, the economic situation gets worse. And I think it's going to get much worse. We're just in the eye of the economic storm right now. As we go out into the economic storm, which will be much worse and last much longer, much, much longer than what happened in 2008 and 2009, there's going to be a cry from the average person all over the world, Europe, China, Japan, US, Canada, everywhere, for the government to do something. Because everybody has been programmed to believe the government's a magic cornucopia that can solve problems, even though it's the one that causes the problems. It's so perverse. It's so bad. Makes me, well, what am I doing on this planet with all these crazy chimpanzees? I must have committed some crime elsewhere in the universe to be put here. I don't know. So I think that the trends in motion tend to stay in motion and to accelerate, much the way when you roll a snowball down a hill from the top of a mountain. It gathers and gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Reach the size of the earth? No. It eventually, when it hits the village at the bottom of the village, and then things start over again. But the thing is only halfway down the mountain yet. So
let the storm follow in my wake.
Problem. What's going to happen? Well, first of all, people shouldn't think politically. I think it's a big mistake on the part of libertarians considering automatically drawn to politics like flies and drawn to a pile of dog crap. So it's a mistake for libertarians, I think, to think politically and talk about politics. I'm doing it now, so I want to identify the problem, okay? But my idea of a proper president, assuming you have to have a president, which I don't assume, is the president of the Swiss Confederation. There's a prosperous, peaceful country. Nobody knows who he is, and nobody cares, because it doesn't make any difference. So that's the ideal president. When it comes to American presidents, my favorite president is William Henry Harrison. Why? Because he was only in office a month before he died. So he couldn't have done much damage. But in those days, the government was vastly less powerful anyway, and therefore much less attractive to sociopaths. So these two parties in the United States, you got the equivalent here. Most countries in the world have a so-called liberal and a so-called conservative party. But they're all quite similar. And it's very interesting. The stupid party, which is the right wing of the Demo-Publican Party, has gotten into the habit of picking old, hostile, mildly demented white men. And the left wing of the Republican Party is more innovative. Now they got a slick young black guy. You know, very presentable, very personable. So this is an interesting runoff they got between these two guys coming up here. But I'll tell you why the average person intuitively despises the right wing of the Demo-Publican Party, the stupid party. They intuitively distrust and despise them because they can intuit that they're dishonest. Why do I say that? It's because the Republicans definitely don't believe in social freedom, but they say they believe in economic freedom. okay? But that's a lie, of course, because most of the worst economic laws have been made under Republicans, as a historical fact. And the left wing of the Republican Party says they believe in social freedom, but they definitely don't believe in economic freedom. So you're offered a Hobson's choice at best. But the worst part of it is that the Republicans always say that they're for capitalism and the free market, and they're the biggest interveners. So you can tell that they're liars, and the laws that they make, they're all to pad the pockets of the people that are biggest campaign donors. So I'm sympathetic with the people that despise the Republican Party, because the Democrats are actually more intellectually honest. I mean, they're despicable, but at least they're honest about their intentions. Just the opposite of Guy Fawkes. One of the things I like about Guy Fawkes is they said he was the only man that ever entered Parliament with honest intentions. So, although I consider him a good guy, the Democrats are kind of like that. But the Republicans are hypocrites, and they're liars, and nobody likes that type of thing, in addition to the kind of candidates that they get, which represent what they are. So my guess is that Obama's going to win this time. It's a toss-up. I'll tell you why. Because the majority of Americans are net recipients of government largesse, and they don't want that to go away, especially during hard times. So they're going to vote their pocketbook. On the other hand, it's like Clinton said when he was running. He said, it's the economy, stupid. And if the economy really falls apart in the next few months, and I don't know if it will or not, then they'll reflexively vote against whoever's in office. But I can't imagine all these poor people voting for Romney. So I don't know. All I feel much more certain about is that the next American election in 2016, I presume we'll have one then, the winner is going to be some left-wing general, because Americans love their military. They just love their military. They're such idiots. And they'll get a left-wing general because Americans trust the military, at least on levels below the Pentagon, which most people kind of understand is corrupt. And they need somebody that's firm, that'll get the country in a grip and turn it around and tell them what to do. So that's my guess. I think we're going to have something approaching a military dictatorship in 2016. But we'll see. I hope I'm dead wrong. But actually, it doesn't matter which one of these morons is elected, because it's very much, the United States is very much in the same position that Rome was in after Augustus. And you know, then they got Tiberius. And he was so terrible in his later years. Everybody was incredibly happy when he died. And they thought, well, it really can't get any worse. But they were wrong. And then they got Claudius, who was a very stupid emperor. He went from evil to stupid. And then, after Claudius, glad he was gone, it's got to get better. No! They went back to evil. They got Caligula. And then, after Caligula, how could it get any worse? Then they got Nero. Well, how could it get any worse? Well, then they got a civil war. So it's not at all an unlikely scenario, I think, for the U.S. Just a brief word about the nation state and democracy. How much time have I taken?
You have another 15 minutes.
Oh, okay. I don't have much more to say about this. I've got to say a few words about democracy, though, because everybody says, well, yeah, but democracy is the answer to this type of thing. But I think that although the nation state itself, an institution which arose in the mid-17th century, generally speaking, people started out with tribes, where you were loyal to other people that you generally shared a common ancestor with, and you were all kind of related, and you all knew each other. And then it moved into empires, Egypt and the Babylonians and the Assyrians and the Romans and so forth. And then it went to the nation state, where you're not, your loyalty is not to Obama or Bush or Reagan, it's to the entity, you know, the country itself. I suppose it's an improvement over the idea of a kingdom, but I mean, it's got to be an improvement over the idea of a kingdom. I mean, how degraded is that to forced to be loyal to some degenerate that's dressed up in purple robes? I mean, it's unbelievable. Yeah, I'm so embarrassed for those poor, stupid Brits who, you know, toast the queen and all this type of things. It's just embarrassed when I'm with these people. So the latest incarnation of the nation state focuses on democracy. And it's really become a secular religion these days. I mean, people think that when you say, it's like saying, well, everybody believes in God. Well, no. Everybody believes in democracy. No, I don't think so. The belief that you can get the lowest common denominator of society to get together and vote in a mob and improve things, it's a giant circle jerk. It's something where everybody thinks they can live at the expense of everybody else. It's a mob rule dressed up in a coat and tie. So no, I decry democracy, and I do that publicly. I had an opportunity yesterday. I was on Russia Today, which along with Al Jazeera is the best news show on TV. I got to do a half an hour of this stuff to the hopeful amusement of RT's viewing public. Patriotism. You're supposed to be patriotic, too. No, I don't believe in patriotism. Patriotism is the belief that your country is the best country in the world just because you happen to be born there. It's a crazy conceit. It makes no sense at all. So what's going to replace this? I think the nation state's a dead man walk. I think it's a dinosaur on its last legs at this point. But they're dangerous. I mean, a big dinosaur, even if it was about to die, is still really dangerous. You want to stay out of its way. I'm a believer in files, some concept that was created by Neal Stephenson, the science fiction writer, and basically posits that with the invention of telecommunication, jet travel, cheap, easy, everywhere, and especially the internet, we can find out who our real countrymen are. We're not medieval serfs anymore, where you live in a little village and you're born there and you don't go more than a day's walk away because there might be dragons over that mountain or something. You heard these stories. So the internet lets you connect with your real countrymen. My real countrymen aren't people that I share government ID from, issued by the US government. Actually, most of my fellow Americans are actually my enemies. They're not my friends. I'd say the average Iranian is much likely to be more of a friend of mine than the average American. Why? Because the average American is a leech trying to take me down. The average Iranian has done me no harm at all. So it's actually exactly the opposite of what most people think, as far as I'm concerned. But the internet, as you all know, can allow you to find your real countrymen. Based on whatever is important to you. Maybe it's a hobby, maybe it's your religion, maybe most people here it's a philosophy, it's a way of living. There are 1,000 reasons why you could want to form friends. Although I think your philosophy and that type of thing is the most important one. But as far as I've said this for years, I'm closer to friends of mine in the Congo than I am to people that live 3 miles down the road from me in Aspen. People in the Congo, I don't share race, I don't share religion, I don't share culture, I don't even share a real common language. But we agree on things that are important. But the people that live down the road, we have no agreement, and those people are an active danger to me. So your real countrymen can be anywhere. I think the way people are going to organize themselves in the future is with files. They're going to find each other and eventually come to agreements for mutual protection, mutual benefit, and so forth. It'll be formalized, so forth. So I'd read Stevenson's book, Diamond Age, which gives a good explanation of the way this type of thing might work. And that's the way I think it's going to go. I don't know how we solve the problem of stupidity and evil. I don't know how we solve the problem of sociopaths. It's an individual thing. You have to solve it, if it's possible to solve, with every person individually, and you're dealing with his individual psyche to try to cure the mental aberrations, which are very mild, or I'd like to think are very mild, with that 80% of people. And then the 20% have more of them, and I don't know how you solve the problem with the really serious ones. That's always going to be there. All you can do, and this is the only reason why politics is important, is you can try to minimize the organizations which make it easy for them to gravitate to each other and get power. And that's all you can do. Other than that, I'd say the best thing to do is to get off this planet. But I don't know where the hell to go at this point. So that's a problem. So I guess I'm here for the duration. You probably are too. So those are just some miscellaneous thoughts on good and evil. A giant asked me to talk about good and evil, or something like that. So. There shouldn't be any questions about that.
Hi, Doug. Thank you for your eloquent, brutal honesty. I really appreciate it. It's very refreshing. So you're among friends here, and you're able to speak the way you have. But let's say when you cross the border and you're accosted by sociopaths in costumes, do you play it maybe more low key? Do you keep your opinions to yourself? So I'm of the same mindset as you. Am I to live my life, you know, under the radar, or am I going to, or should I beat my chest and be proud of it?
That's a very direct and important question. How do you react to these people? My problem is I just can't fucking help myself. And it's like, I'll tell you, the last time I entered the United States, I was coming from Zurich by way of Madrid. And so it was a long flight. I got in at 6 o'clock in the morning or something like that. And this is the way it happens. I always keep my frown. I never smile with them. I'm businesslike. I'm not looking for trouble. But, you know, I don't like being annoyed. So I'm going through the line. I'm reading my magazine, which I've been reading, standing in this line. And, you know, out of the corner of my eye, I'm looking at, you know, these other chimpanzees and how they're reacting to this, because it's kind of interesting. I go back to reading my magazine. It's my turn. Go up, throw my passport in front of her. She can read it. It's a young girl. She's early 30s, probably. And go back to reading my magazine. And she says, you know, would you look at me, please? So I looked at her like she's a bug. And, you know, and then she starts asking me some questions. I don't know. They seem to be the same questions she was asking everybody, because it was taking like 2 or 3 minutes with everybody, interrogating them. So one of the questions she asked, do you have over $10,000? And I said, no. And go back to my magazine while she's playing with the passport and playing with the computer and all this type of thing. And more questions and so forth. And then she asked me again. And she says, do you have over $10,000? And I looked and I said, what did I just tell you? You know, and of course, you know what happens now. She takes out a red pen and marks an S on it. And I say, oh, Jesus. You know, this, I know the drill. So I get my bag, and, you know, it's hot in the customs area there. And I flew into Miami from Madrid. And so here I am, going for secondary with the bag, and I'm sweating. This is like a signal that these guys are supposed to pick up on. And so I go to the secondary guy, and one of the guys is the secondary before me. He's not an American. I see the customs guy say, Show me what's in your pockets. Yes, the guy turned his pockets inside out. Jesus, this is gonna be something. And so, drag up there, and I wait for the question. So he asked me where you're coming from. The answer is, he says, what do you do? And I said, why were you in Zurich? To give a speech. So what do you do? I'm a writer and a speaker. And I'll tell you, it was the most amazing. Maybe these guys are all told things. And he didn't open my bag. He didn't ask me any more questions. He just said, it's the most amazing. So maybe, you know, if you tell them you're in a position to, you know, make their life, to draw attention to them. So that's what I do. I just do what I do. I don't try to be an actor. I'm not a very good actor. I just act like myself. And I really don't give a damn. If they take me into a back room, maybe I'll miss my flight, but I'll have a new experience. Just like Rick said, the good news is I'll have something to talk to you about the next time. So that's my answer. I'm not looking for trouble. I just act like myself.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry that doesn't suit him most of the time.
Okay, Doug, I've got the next question. Oh. I know you're personal friends with Ron Paul. Do you believe he's innately corrupt?
No. Just like I don't believe that most of the founding fathers were innately corrupt. I think they had a situation that people in government call a situation. And most of them were goodwill farmers and merchants, tried to do the right thing. And there's small remnants of them hanging around. So I'd say one out of, how many people in Congress are there, 500 and something? I'd say one out of 500 people in the world, probably statistically average. It's a bell-shaped curve going both ways. Yeah. So no, I think he's an okay guy.
An ally has been
slain. Last question.
Last question.
This one I can't help but asking, how do you feel about what the metals markets are doing, and why are they so boring? Do you think the mania 2 years ago, all the silver bugs going crazy on the internet, you think that was a little localized phenomenon? What do you see going forward?
Well, look, I'm a big metals bull. I really am. It's the only financial asset that's not simultaneously somebody else's liability. All these paper currencies are eventually going to reach their intrinsic value. I don't know what's going to happen to the stock market in general. I think the economy is going to be rough. I think that is a speculation. I think these mining stocks are getting to be really interesting now. I'm not saying it's the bottom, but I think it's approaching the bottom. So that's what I'd say. And I continue to buy gold and silver. I continue to buy gold and silver. But that's all I can say. But all over the world, what's happening is it's becoming, they're clamping down. Like I found out just yesterday, you all may not know this, but it's impossible. It's illegal. Can't be done. For a non-Canadian or a non-Canadian resident, proven by a visa in their passport to open a Canadian bank account now. If you're not a Canadian, and I don't mean you can be a non-American. Go in, they won't open your account for you here in Canada. So it's changing everywhere. They're clamping down. I hate to leave on such a high note.
Thank you, Doug Casey, and also, of course, thank you, Rick Rule, two mentors of mine.
The next speaker has been known, I'm sure, to all of you for many years. He's been a business associate,
in fact, a mentor, and a close friend of mine for 30 years. He is also one who walks the walk in the context of my speech last year. It's one thing to deliver a message. It's another thing to be the message. Doug Casey has used the fact that he has been a successful human being and a successful speculator for 30 years to use his status of being a success in life to convey the message of liberty. Usually people aren't interested in abstracts because they don't know the benefit to them of abstract knowledge. But if the promise in front of them is, I will teach you how to become richer and tell you about a stock that's going to go from 10 cents to a dollar, and then presto, change-o, we talk about anarchy, liberty, and freedom, the audience, if not involved, is in fact present. Doug Casey has been tireless for 30 years explaining correctly how success in life, success in investing, and success philosophically are all completely intertwined. Doug Casey also has an absolutely amazing ability to take complex topics and either in speaking or in writing make them simple and understandable. I've wondered for years how he has done this. I thought for a while that he must be a uniquely empathetic human being. Then, of course, I got to know him and discovered that that wasn't true. What I've decided, really, in my declining years is that he is so smart and so knowledgeable and so persistent with regards to, and also, by the way, so outrageous, so fearless, that he succeeds just by force of intellect and force of will. But you didn't come here to hear me, or if you did, you already did. So, ladies and gentlemen, Doug Casey. Thank you, Rick. Thank you. Thank you all for being here. What I want to talk about today, and I'll get right into it because I've got a lot of things to say. I want to talk about conflated, confused, and misused words. And the reason I want to do that is because over the years I've become kind of a stickler on not just saying what you mean and meaning what you say, but making sure that the words that you use to say something are accurate. Because if you don't define words accurately, then maybe you don't actually know what you're talking about. And certainly the other person that's listening to you also won't know. Maybe you're using different words to describe the same thing, or the same words to describe different things. And what we have is a failure to communicate. And so let me go through a bunch of words, or pairs of words, that I think a lot of people don't actually know what they mean. And since I just came from a financial conference, let me start with some financial ones, which are kind of interesting. They just kind of annoy me. That also kind of relate to the bigger society that we're in. Ton. They say, okay, you've got a ton of ore. Okay, that's fine. Miners use ore by the ton. But which ton is it? T-O-N or T-O-N-N? I'm sure everybody here knows the difference, right? Well, maybe not. That doesn't bother me so much, that people interchange T-O-N and T-O-N-N-E, because one, of course, is a short English ton, and the other is a long metric ton, 2,000 pounds as opposed to 2,204 pounds or something like that. But here's what bothers me. Most of you guys are interested in gold, I presume. Well, you should be, right now, anyway. And all the time now, they're describing gold in tons. The IMF sold 3 tons of gold. The US owns 8,000 tons of gold. And since this meme started describing gold in tons, it's spread. Now, it's incredibly stupid and counterproductive from a liberty point of view if you believe that gold has anything to do with liberty. Why? Because nobody uses gold by the ton. Nobody but maybe governments buy or sell it by the ton, so it becomes kind of an abstract, a meaningless concept, tons of gold. Nobody owns a ton of gold. Incidentally, how much is a ton of gold? Let me get this right. It's 32,150 ounces, okay? But then they say T-O-N as opposed to T-O-N-N-E, and you don't even know how much it is. Anyway, I refuse to talk about gold in tons. It's priced in ounces, dollars per ounce. So why do they talk about it in tons when it's bought and sold and used and priced in ounces? I think the reason that this thing started, I think it was started by the bad guys, is to make gold even more of an abstract that's meaningless than it is now. So, just a point. Look out. Be sure when you're talking to somebody who talks about gold in tons, there's something wrong there. Another thing, financial thing. They talk about the bond market. And of course, as we speak right now, we're in the middle of the biggest financial bubble in all of history, and it happens to be a bond bubble. Well, wait a minute. Remember they used to say years ago, bonds and debentures? They used to say that. What's the difference between a bond and a debenture? Well, a bond was something that was secured by an actual asset. That was kind of security for the bond. And a debenture was, well, what a bond is. There was no backing except the general credit of the company or whatever it was. Well, interestingly, everything is a bond today. And the word debenture has kind of been gone down the Orwellian memory hole. And I'm like, nobody's ever heard of a debenture anymore. But they should, because there's a distinction between a bond and a debenture. And I wonder why. It's very interesting. Because bonds really aren't bonds anymore, because they're not bonding a specific thing. They're all debentures in today's world. And this is also a sign of an economy that's, well, same problem as with ounces. The other one, deposits and demand deposits. People who don't have gray hair probably may not have even heard those terms, time deposit and demand deposit. In fact, people think a time deposit was basically a savings account, and a demand deposit was basically a checking account. And everybody said, yeah, I got a savings account and a checking account. But there's really no difference between them now. I mean, they transfer money from one to the other. It used to be when banking was in the 1970s, classical banking, demand deposits, time deposits, checking accounts, and savings accounts were as different as night and day, separate businesses. I mean, they're as different as lions and antelopes. Because there's no difference between these things today. A time deposit is one where you gave a bank a dollar for a specific period of time. That's why it's called a time deposit. And then it became a savings account. Now it's nothing. Why? Because the bank, if it's going to make a loan, which is how it makes money, it would maybe give you 3% and lend it out to a businessman for 6%. $1,000 for a year, it can lend it out for a year and capture that 3% difference to cover its profit, its expenses, and set up a loss reserve. So banks lend out like 30-year mortgages with money that can come and go in a minute. This is why all the banks are at least liquid, and I think almost all of them are insolvent. So that's time deposits or savings accounts. And then you have demand deposits or checking accounts. Totally different. Why? Because instead of paying for the money, you have to pay the bank for storing the money securely and giving you the right to transfer it by writing a check. Why should a bank do that for free? Store it securely and pay a check. You can charge for that.
lost on all this stuff today. Another reason why the banks are all very, very much in trouble today. Anyway, these are shares that aren't in use today. Investments, I don't know the difference between that either. That's a very important difference. When people don't understand these basic, you know, everything you hear on television is like a 60-second thing where they're throwing these words around that are undefined and the talking head doesn't know what he's talking about, certainly. Investment. Investment is putting aside capital in order to create more capital. That is what an investment is, okay? It's different from savings. Savings is the excess of production over consumption, okay? That becomes savings, and then you can use that savings as investment, or you can use it for other things. But nobody makes this distinction anymore. And why is, everybody hates savings. They say consumption is good. We live in a consumer society. Well, wait a minute. Isn't it better to live in a producer society? How do you get things to consume if you don't produce them first? And how do you get capital to make savings unless you produce more than you consume? And people don't even look at these basic, actually simple things. And people say, what did Cheney say a few years ago? Debt doesn't matter, okay? Well, it does, because when you have savings, it means you're like a squirrel. I mean, we're all wired in the back of our brains like squirrels. A squirrel knows, I gotta save some nuts for the winter, or I'm gonna starve to death. That's why you see squirrels running around the fall saving nuts, okay? Well, we're like that too. I mean, even people on welfare kind of understand this basic thing. Savings is good, because it means you've got production for the future that's put aside. What about debt? If you have debt, it means you've been living above your means, okay? And if I borrow $1 million today, I can live high off the hog for the next year. But if I'm ever gonna pay it back, I'm not only gonna have to radically reduce my standard of living, but it's gonna be worse than that, because I'm gonna have to pay interest on the debt besides. So yeah, debt does matter. Anyway, speculation and gambling. People say, that's a crazy speculation. It's just gambling. Well, not if you think about it. What's a speculation? Well, a couple ways to define it, but the way I like to define speculation is it's an allocation of capital in a way that you take advantage of politically caused distortions in the marketplace. The classic speculation of our time was gold in 1971, $35 an ounce. It had been suppressed in price by the government for 40 years, and you knew it was going to explode. So that's the kind of thing a speculator looks for. It's not what a gambler does. I mean, a gambler is looking at a roll of the dice or a turn of a roulette wheel. So don't conflate those two things. And a lot of people think they're investing and they don't know anything about speculating, and they're actually gambling. So, I mean, I've made all these mistakes. Another financial problem is where and when. I'd like to find out exactly when. We all know what a shareholder is, okay? Somebody that owns part of an enterprise. What in hell is a stakeholder? You don't hear about shareholders anymore. They're just a nuisance. You hear about stakeholders, people that have nothing in the game, that are basically parasites, but people treat them like they're important. And this wasn't a word that was even used until about the same, this stuff has been happening within the last 50 years, incidentally. That's how I know about it. Because when I was a kid, I knew about these distinctions. We didn't have stakeholders back then. And now people take this concept seriously. It shouldn't be taken seriously. It's laughable. Now, there is no such thing as a stakeholder. If you want to be a stakeholder, buy a share in the company, and then you can talk. Inflation and deflation. Okay, this is also very confused. in people's minds. You know, they say it's confused in a different way. Inflation is where it's an increase in the money supply, which has various effects. And deflation means a decrease in the money supply. But actually, what now is inflation is something that has nothing to do with the money supply. It's what happens to prices in the money supply. In other words, inflation is something that happens to the money supply. But today, people think of inflation as something that happens to prices of goods. So this confuses people's thoughts about where inflation comes from. If you understand you only have inflation because of an increase in the money supply, okay. But if you think inflation is the price of bread or gasoline going up, it's not the government's fault. It's those damned oil producers' fault, or it's those damn bakers' fault. So you wind up blaming the people that are fighting inflation, not the people that are causing inflation. So this is, once again, this is sloppy, muddled thinking, and it plays into the advantage of the bad guys. So many of these things. Look, money. What is money? Money is a medium of exchange of a store of value. Historically, I mean, salt, cows, lots of things have been used for money, cigarettes. But historically, the best money always turns out, for many reasons that I won't even go into, to be gold, or maybe sometimes silver, or even sometimes copper. But today, people conflate that. It used to be that you'd have a banknote. And how would you get a banknote? Because you'd take your gold down to the bank, and you'd get a receipt for leaving your gold with them. That was a banknote. If it was a demand deposit, they'd give you a banknote. Because you could give it to somebody else, and then he could get your gold in the bank. But then the banknote, governments started getting into the money game, and they started issuing banknotes, and they called them currency, okay? And now, there's not even that. Money is made out of credit. This is a whole different thing to talk about. And this isn't the forum, because I got a lot of other things to talk about here. But I'm just trying to say there are distinctions here that have been lost and confused and conflated and misused. Now, getting away from the financial stuff, and I'm trying to get away from the financial stuff too. I mean, because guys like Rick are on the ground every day. You got other guys, you got Adrian and Paul, and I don't know who else is here that's a financial guy. But, you know, I kind of been there and done that, so I want to do that less. I don't want to stay a one-trick pony my whole life. So I'm getting out of the financial business. So let me get away from these financial terms here. People that use the word we, unless they're close friends of mine, I get very scary. And when they add the word should to the we, you know, there is no we should, okay? Not unless we're really good buddies and we know how each other think. But all the time, you hear these talking heads and political people, we should. No. If you want to, you should. I don't want to do it, okay? And people let them get away with this. I mean, it's incredible to me. This is a part of the politically correct syndrome. Politically correct. You know, that word, that phrase, when I first heard that phrase, that's not politically correct, I thought it was a joke. I honestly thought, I think I might have even heard it in a joking context. I actually thought when people talked about politically correct or politically incorrect, I thought it was funny. And then it became real, and now it's it's like a, yes, it's everywhere. They take this completely serious, and every day it gets worse and worse and worse. So part of this is diversity. We've got to have diversity, you know? No, we don't have to have diversity at all. If you want diversity, you can have it. If you don't want diversity, you don't have to have it. If you want a store, and you don't want to let black people in, I think that's very stupid. But it's your store, okay? You don't have to have diversity in your store. You have diversity in your schools. And none of this. It's all complete nonsense. And this goes along, well, wait a minute. At the same time as we have diversity, we've got to have unity. I'm confused. I don't believe in unity, because in order to have unity, you have to address the lowest common denominator to get everybody to agree on something. That's how you get unity. And then you could all, you know, march off or what do chimpanzees do? Anyway, it's like a bunch of chimpanzees. They're all united in the pack. But so we got to have diversity and unity both. And nobody ever explained that to me, how this happens. And then, you know, it used to be it was okay to have privacy. But then they said, no, that's like secrecy, and secrecy is bad. I don't know why secrecy is bad, but these are other words. And now transparency, you know? You're not supposed to not have privacy or not have secrecy. You're supposed to actually have transparency. So it's not like a negative, having a negative. You've got to have a positive, where you actually, far from keeping things private, or God forbid, secret, you've got to actually show things and be transparent. So this is another way that society is changing with the use of these words, that people use these words and they think that that's the way the world works. So I think transparency is another word that, you know, people just use because all the other chimpanzees are using it. I don't like transparency. Another one is fair. Let's be fair about this. You're not treating those workers fairly. I'd like you to be fair. That's not a fair deal. Fair? What in hell is fair? You know, fair is, you got one idea of fair, got another idea. We all got different ideas of fair as far as how to split this pie up that I guess we all own together, okay? I got a better idea. Why don't we just shit-can the word fair and use the word just? I like just better, because what does just mean? I don't know what fair means. I'm not sure anybody knows what fair means, but I know what just means. It means getting what you deserve. That's what just means. It's just if you get what you deserve. Now, we have to figure out what we all deserve, but, you know, we can do an exploration. It's usually just, you deserve it if you produced it or if you bought it or traded for it and so forth. So we can figure out what just is. We can't figure out what fair is. But I never see the word just used. I see the word fair used all the time. And I don't like it. Ah, there's so much of this. The language is so corrupted. In my opinion, the whole society is corrupted. But it often starts with language, because language is the father to what we think and what we believe. And what you think and what you believe is the father to what you do. So you corrupt the language, you're corrupting the whole society. That's why I'm talking about all these things, okay? Hate speech. This is recent, too. About 10 years ago? I don't know. You can check, see when hate speech became an actual thing. I've always thought we had freedom of speech. You could say whatever you want. You just can't do whatever you want, okay? And I don't like things that are generally called hate speech, because generally they're in bad taste, quite frankly. They're unseemly, and polite people don't do hateful things, and it shows you're badly brought up and so forth. But it's one thing to identify something as hate speech, which sometimes is just the identification of an actual fact, quite frankly. Then making laws against it. Wait a minute, what did Orwell say about this, you know? He had a lot of things. Love is hate, the ministry of truth, where everything's backwards. And I think hate speech is the next step in the direction of liberal society, trying to figure out what stuff is and prosecuting people for saying it. Here's a trivial thing that's always annoyed me. This started with CNN. Thankfully, is going out of business. Remember, to amuse their idiotic viewers, they said, here's your factoid of the day, okay? Well, I don't want a factoid, because you know what a factoid is? People seem to think it's a little fact, like one sentence, you know, like, you know, a kilogram is 2.2 pounds. There's your factoid. It's not a factoid. What is a factoid? What is an android? An android is an artificial man. What is an asteroid? An asteroid is like a, it looks like a star, but it's not a star. So, well, what's a factoid? It looks like a fact, but it's not a fact, or it's an incorrect fact. But everybody uses this like factoid. Here's a factoid. I don't want a factoid. I want a fact. And if it's a, and if it's a little fact, call it a factet. But you know, this thing starts, and it's a sign of sloppy thinking. It really is. Well, I got a. That's a trivial example. I got a non-trivial example for you. You watch the news and you say, the U.S. decided to attack Afghanistan today, or France decided to whatever. It's, first of all, let's talk about the U.S. What is the U.S.? To me, it's the geographical area bounded by that line with Canada on the north and Mexico on the south. That's what the U.S. is. But people confuse that with the U.S. government, because every time you hear the U.S., almost every time, they're not talking about the U.S., which is an area with 320 million people. They're talking about the U.S. government, which is a certain group in and around the Beltway in Washington. So this is very confusing. It means that what they do in Washington means it's what we're doing. And so don't say that. Don't say, you know, the U.S. did this. No, they didn't. The U.S. government did this. And make that distinction, because then, I mean, I don't care if people hate the U.S. government, but I don't want them to hate U.S. residents. And, you know, they'll conflate that, because they'll think, well, we're responsible for it. But it's even worse than that, because they say, well, I'm an American, and America did this. And this is incredibly stupid, because what is America? I'll tell you what I think America is. America isn't even a geographical place like the U.S. is. America is an idea, and it was a very good idea, an excellent, a unique idea. But America doesn't even exist. So how can they talk about America? America's dead and buried. It's gone. We're farther away from America than we are from the Roman Empire. We're actually getting closer to the Roman Empire than we were to America. No, but they still use America. I mean, to me, America was California girls and hot dogs and apple pie and all that. But America is now about F-35s and B-2s and things like that. Anyway, America was a concept. So don't conflate that with the U.S. And then people go on to conflate the U.S. with the U.S. government. So we're like three standard deviations, not just one, three standard deviations away from the truth, if you follow me. Now here's another one that's political. Healthcare. Everybody believes in healthcare, don't they? Everybody likes healthcare. It's a good idea. Yes, okay, I agree. Healthcare is a wonderful idea, but healthcare is something you provide for yourself. How do you do that? You do that through diet and exercise and, you know, good habits and staying away from bad habits, and that's how you provide healthcare to yourself. And seeing your doctor once in a while if you need to. How can the government give you healthcare? That is an individual thing, but people, the government, and people like them, love to use the idea of health care. Everybody wants to be healthy, so we want health care. But you're not getting healthy, you're getting medical care. And medical care is different. It's like if you have your leg blown off. You don't need health care, you need medical care. Okay? You know, medical care is like things like that, okay? Auto accident or something. So something you pay a doctor for, okay? Healthcare is something that is organic that you provide for yourself, basically. You're responsible for yourself. If I have healthcare, I'm responsible for myself. If the government has healthcare, they're responsible for me. So once again, you see the subtle difference here? This is running across all these words, okay? Medical care. Don't say healthcare. Next. We watch the news, okay? And we know that there's a civil war going on in the Ukraine, right? No, wrong. It's not a civil war, which is what they always say. It is a war of succession. A civil war is like the Spanish Civil War, where two groups were trying to capture the government in Madrid. Or like the Chinese Civil War, when Mao and Chiang Kai-shek were trying to capture the government of China. That's a civil war, okay? Where two groups are trying to capture the same government. So what's in the Ukraine? That is a war of secession. Those provinces in the eastern Ukraine, you can say, they're puppets of the Russians. Well, yeah, maybe they are. I mean, people always get in wars and get involved in civil wars and wars of secession and all that, and everybody's a puppet of somebody else, I guess. But the fact is that Donetsk and Lugansk are trying to secede from the rest of the Ukraine, which incidentally isn't even a real country. It's kind of a political intertidal zone where, you know, Romanians and Hungarians and Lithuanians and Poles and Russians all kind of gravitate around this, where there's some Ukrainians, but you know, the borders keep ebbing and flowing. So I think it's perfectly natural and good that these two provinces are trying to secede. In fact, I'd like to not only see that happen, but I'm all in back of the Basques and the Catalans seceding from Spain, and the Scots and the Welsh from the UK, and the same thing. In fact, we have about 225 countries in the world today. I'd like to see 2,225. I'd ultimately like to see about 7 billion little countries in the world today. So you should back these people in the eastern Ukraine. Sure, I mean, for all I know, they're Stalinists. I don't know, I don't care. It's a step in the right direction, okay? But it is not a civil war, and don't let anybody say that. Oh, incidentally, talking about civil wars, the unpleasantness in the United States from 1861 to 1865, that wasn't a civil war, that was a war of secession. So you should call it the war between the states, or you can call it the war of Southern Secession, or you can call it the War of Northern Aggression, but don't call it the U.S. Civil War, and you should correct people. I mean, take opportunities to straighten these things out, you know? I mean, charity begins at home, okay? So you can do this too. This is another one that's useful also. Weapons of mass destruction. What in hell are they? Well, they're supposed to be atomic or biological or chemical weapons. And I don't know how this meme got started, probably about 20 years ago. It used to be, those were called, in the military, that's what they were called. They were called ABC weapons or NBC weapons. Very specific, atomic weapons. Dealing with. They're actually unconventional weapons. That's what they are, unconventional weapons used by the military. They called them ABC. And then, I think this started with Saddam Hussein in the first Iraq war. That's about when it came in. Weapons of mass destruction. Because it sounds a lot more terrifying and deadly than ABC weapons, you know, really. But what are weapons of mass destruction? Well, atomic weapons definitely are. Biological? No. There's been no biological weapon developed that can do other than, I mean, yes, I guess you could say
biological weapons were used against the American Indians historically. But that's not really, biological weapons have been uniquely unsuccessful. They're not weapons of mass destruction. Can cause damage. Chemical weapons, very hard to use them. They're not weapons of mass destruction. What's a weapon of mass destruction? It's a B-52 raid. It's an artillery barrage. That's mass destruction. So this is conflating things again to scare the chimpanzees, okay? ABC weapons doesn't scare you. They don't understand. Weapons of mass destruction, whatever that is, that scares them. Okay, another problem. Concentration camps, okay? You know, when I was in college, people used to say, the U.S. will never have concentration camps. We'll call them something else. And it was a joke. We all thought it was funny. And it turned out to be exactly what happened. We call them detention facilities. Detention facilities. So, you know, that's another good one. Sure, of course we have concentration camps. The thing at Guantanamo is a concentration camp. Well, yeah, but it has fighters in it. Wait a minute, they're not fighters, they're what kind of combatants are they?
Insurgents.
No. Enemy combatants, yes. I mean, we don't know if they're enemy combatants, because very, very few of them were actually caught in combat. I mean, they're just called that. This is a new class of person to be an enemy combatant. And if you're accused of being an enemy combatant, then you can be put in a detention facility. So this is another thing to look out for. Well, actually it started after World War II. It used to be, up until 1946, when the U.S. Government was reorganized, actually. In fact, some people say it was actually a kind of a palace coup. It used to be, if the U.S. government wanted to go off and kill people in a foreign country, they had the War Department and the Navy Department. What's the difference? Well, the War Department used to be the thing that if you declared war, you'd go off and, you know, use the army to do whatever they're going to do. And then you have the Navy Department, which was sailing around the world, and they had a little more. But then it was all put together in the Defense Department. Wait a minute. It's not the War Department, where we know what a war is. Now it's the Defense Department. And oddly enough, since we've had the Defense Department in 1946, there has not been a war, a declared war. But there's been about 50 undeclared wars. But there really weren't when the Defense Department was there. Yeah, they did some things in Guatemala and places like that. But I found this very interesting, that since we've had the Defense Department and the War Department went away, there actually are no wars, declared wars, but there's lots of wars. Very strange. I don't know what's going on. I think it has to do with the creation or the development, not the creation, of the deep state. Yeah, this is kind of interesting. Some of you guys probably, I'm a personal friend of Ron Paul, and I like Ron. And even if Ron Paul had won the last time that he won, it wouldn't have done any good at all. Why? Because, I'll tell you, because of the existence of the deep state in the U.S., this is the interconnection of industry and science and government and the military and all of them, and they all have common interests and they all slop at the same trough and they all think the same way. They share the same philosophy and they all gravitate towards the government because they all, you know, it's like flies around dog do. So it's perfectly predictable. And there actually is, I believe, something called the deep state. So if Ron Paul had actually been elected, I'll tell you what would have happened. Like the first, you know, week or month, he would have been in office when they saw this guy's gonna might get a little bit out of control. All the directors of the Praetorian agencies, CIA,
FBI, NSA, there's a score of them. All those guys with a whole bunch of generals would get together with them, and they'd tell them the way things are. And I think if he didn't get the idea, he might disappear, okay? Or maybe not. Maybe they just give him the word and see what happens next. And what would happen next is the Congress would impeach him, or the Supreme Court would say something that's everything's illegal. And if that didn't work, which it would, then all of your average Americans would get out into the streets, because as you know, they say that 47% of Americans receive more from the government than they pay into the government. Of course, I don't believe anybody should pay anything into the government, but 47% of people get more than they give to the government. So it's screwed up on both the getting and the giving side. And people think that's perfectly normal. You know, hey, you're not supposed to get benefits unless you pay taxes. Well, I suppose that's true, but I don't want to get anything or give anything. Anyway, 47% of the country right now. So Ron Paul, nothing would have happened. It would have been a disaster. Nothing would have changed. And the deep state, which is all these people in big industry and big medicine and military and all these agencies and these 3 million government employees, they're all on the same team, okay? So forget about it. There are no political solutions. It's strictly to, you know, to make us think that we're free or whatever. What else? Ah, wait a minute. You can't say these things and be a patriot. Patriot. I'm not even sure that that's a good thing. But in fact, most people, patriotism's good, right? Everybody says patriotism's good. Well, I don't know. I'm not sure. What am I patriotic of? I mean, patriotic for my city? What if my city broke off from the U.S.? Would I be patriotic and not patriotic for my state? My state broke off? Or the U.S.? What are you supposed to be patriotic to? What is your, you know, how the hell are people patriotic to Canada, for God's sake? I mean, it's an agglomeration. I mean, Canada really should break up, just like the U.S. should break up. I mean, the U.S., from a cultural point of view, I mean, assuming you wanted to even have these stupid political entities, it should probably be at least 6 different things. And Canada should be, I'd say, and then you probably have those prairie provinces. Sure. So Canada ought to be, culturally speaking, at least 5 different places anyway. So I don't know what this patriotism is about. I really don't. But actually, you know, that's kind of warm and fuzzy to be a patriot, you know. It means that you're only a chimpanzee that starts hooting and panting in wartime or when we are under threat somehow. I don't feel under threat. But most of these people are actually nationalists, okay? And a nationalist is supposed, you know, wants to line up in back of our leaders and the government. But actually, you shouldn't even call them nationalists. They're really jingoists. I mean, really, they're just a emotional, semi-psychopathic people that take this whole illusion seriously. So that's all. Let's throw up. Instead of trying to, let's just throw all 3 of those words in the shit can. But wait a minute. If I'm not going to be one of those things, then I must be an isolationist. Okay? Anybody that doesn't want to, you know, send the troops over there before the guys that are living in caves send their high-tech army over here, I'm an isolationist. Actually, I'm just a non-interventionist. You know, fights between people. I don't even know who's right. And this thing with ISIS or ISIL, whichever it is, I mean, it's, you know, after they take over a certain amount of land, you know, what's going to happen to them is the same thing that happens to every organization. It'll become electrified and concrete bound and bureaucratized, and it'll be just like another one of those nothing, nowhere states in the Middle East that you can't even find them on a map. So forget about it, okay? Forget about it. You don't have anything to, you know, send in the Marines or whoever they're going to do for that. And none of these countries, you all know this, not one country in Africa is a real country, kind of. Like, you could say France is kind of a real country, although even then you can make arguments that France is artificial. But none of those countries in Africa or the Middle East or Central Asia, none of them. They're all just artificial lines on a map where then the government decides to defend the lines on a map that some guys in Europe drew 100 years ago. We got hot buttons. It's discrimination and racism. You're not supposed to. If I'm walking down the street and there's, you know, three or four, you know, white guys wearing ties, and I'm not too worried that anybody, but if I'm walking down the street and there's a half a dozen young black guys with boomboxes, so I'm discriminating, okay? So we don't need to go into all this. It's actually quite rational to discriminate. But you have to be intelligent about these things. And you don't make laws about these things. So, well, people that, you know, people say, our heroes in uniform, our heroes in the army. Well, I don't know if they're heroes. I mean, some are, I guess. What's a hero? I don't know. A hero is generally defined as somebody who does something with a great amount of courage with a large amount of personal risk involved. That's what a hero is. And I don't know, most of the cops and the soldiers, they're just government employees, frankly. And they're not heroes because they want to be heroes. If they get into a nasty situation, maybe they're going to be heroes because they owe the guy next to us. They don't care about patriotism or anything like that. They just want to stay alive. And to stay alive, maybe you've got to do something that's courageous. So calling all these people in uniform heroes is ridiculous and disgusting. And they should be caught up on it. And the word heroes become totally degraded. Like the whole society has become degraded at this point. It's embarrassing. Anyway, cops are not peace officers. Nobody uses that term anymore, okay? They don't keep the peace. They enforce the laws. That's a totally different thing. And most of these laws are not worth enforcing. You know how I feel about laws. I mean, people say, well, the only laws we need are the Ten Commandments. And I say, really? I mean, first of all, I can't even remember them. And the Catholics and the Protestants and the Jews all have different versions of the Ten Commandments. And the Ten Commandments are pretty stupid, frankly, because the first three are about how you should worship no other gods and so forth. You know, so three of them are irrelevant, you know, if you're a thinking person, I think. And so, no, that's too many. And people say, well, okay, all right. It's fashionable to say that actually, there should be just two laws, okay? Do all that you say you're going to do, and don't aggress against other people or their property. You know what? Ignorance of the law is no excuse. If you only got two laws, and they're simple and commonsensical like those two laws, do all that you say you're going to do, and don't aggress against other people or their property. Okay, everybody knows those laws, and ignorance of the law is no excuse when there's only ignorance of the law is an excuse when it's a library that'll fill this room with trivia. But you know what? Just as scientists for many years have been trying to boil down the universe into just one great law, you know, you've got the, you got the law of gravity, you've got the law of electromagnetism, you've got the strong force, the weak force, I'm trying to boil that into one great law somehow. Okay, I've done it from a moral point of view. You don't even need those two laws that I just mentioned. You want to know it? There's only one law. Let me give it to you. the whole of the law shall be do as thou wilt. But be prepared to accept the consequences. As long as you remember that second phrase, you're okay, because then, before you do anything, you've got to figure out what the consequences are, which helps people to think. It's just obeying some idiot law that's made by a legislature. It doesn't help people to think. It helps them to act like robots instead. So, hold the laws, do as thou wilt. Anything. Anything you want. Go ahead. But be prepared to accept the consequences. Now, what are the consequences of that? And it gets very interesting. And generally speaking, if people think things out that way, they'll do the right thing. And then, if they do the wrong thing, they'll get what they deserve. Hopefully justice, not fair treatment, whatever that is. I mean, this all ties together, I think. So, but forget about that. If you try to explain any of this to the cop that's busting you, you know, I mean, he's, you know, all he does is enforce the laws. He's just a paid employee of the state. He's not a hero. And he's not wearing a uniform. That's another thing, you know. Be proud to wear your country's uniform. Well, what's the difference between a uniform and a costume? You know? And most of these guys are clowns. I have to be so careful about saying this kind of stuff, though, because yesterday, this was just yesterday, this happens a lot to me. Just yesterday, after Marin Katusa gave his workshop and he invited Paul Van Eden and I to, you know, kind of be up there with them and do point counterpoint. And so we were strictly talking about mining, the whole half hour, nothing but mining, nothing. And so after it, some guy comes up to me and he says, what did he say? He said, his opening thing was, said, were you in the service? And I explained, no, I wasn't in the service. And he says, well, I don't like your views on the military. I said, I didn't say anything about that. I mean, I pushed this guy's button, or he thought I pushed his button, or he read something that pushed his button. He had, you know, he had some kind of an engram where he hears this, therefore he's got to react this way. You know, a hostile guy. But I get this quite a bit. I mean, it amuses me. It doesn't bother me. But I just point that out because, you know, when you say things that are at odds with what most people believe or what most people think they believe or actually what most people think they're supposed to believe because they don't know, you know, it pushes people's buttons. And it's a stimulus response reaction as opposed to a thought out thing. Then they want to argue. They don't want to discuss or explore. They want to argue. Boring waste of time. Anyway, I don't know if I'm over time. We got time for a question or a reaction. Reaction, like that. Yeah, like that guy. Yes. Yes.
Hi, you talk about capitalism and morality and how then the rest of the world talk as an oxymoron. And I think part of the problem is that we really do not have a clear definition of capitalism or morality for that.
Very good. Very good. That's a softball. And I think I must have skipped over that on my list. Capitalism. That was a term that was coined by, of all people, Karl Marx. I mean, that's a little known fact. Factet, yes. So, capitalism, I think it's the natural order of things, quite frankly. It's not a system, it's actually a free market. I mean, capitalism is a It's a problem. I think it's a problematical concept and a problematical word, because in point of fact, and I'm dodging defining it exactly right now, but let me instead define two other things that are often confused with it. And the most important of them is fascism. Everybody thinks fascism's got something to do with black uniforms and jackboots and racism and that whole shtick. Actually, it's got nothing to do with that. Fascism is an economic system. And to take a Marxist breakdown of this, Marx would have said, capitalism, a system, and I'm trying to define it now, a system where both private, personal property, cars, clothes, toothbrushes, stuff like that, it doesn't produce stuff necessarily. That's privately owned. And also, the means of production, mines, fields, factories, et cetera, they're also privately owned. And both are privately controlled. Privately owned, privately controlled, consumer goods and means of production, capitalism. Usually, almost always confused with fascism. What's fascism? Fascism is where private goods are privately owned. Your car, your house, your toothbrush in Nazi Germany or all kinds of, every other country in the world because they're almost all fascist today. But the means of production are privately owned. I mean, General Motors kind of, but certainly Apple and Google and all that are owned by the shareholders. But much more important, they're controlled by the state. It's all controlled by the state. And you get to trade your stock certificates and you buy and sell and can start stuff and all that. And the state likes that. The state has discarded communism. I should have started from the other end, to be more logical. Because they've seen what happens when there's too much state. It's better when you have something resembling a free market. That's fascism. Fascism is technically where everything's privately owned, but state controlled. And that's the difference between fascism and capitalism. The whole world today is fascist. How about socialism? Socialism is where the means of production are owned by the state, but private goods are privately owned, although controlled by the state. So, do we have any socialist states in the world today? China is still a little bit kind of semi-socialist. They own their state-owned industries. I think we got a few state-owned industries here in North America. A little bit of socialism. So it's not pure fascism everywhere. Melange is socialist. I don't know if we have any even pure socialist states in the world today where all the means of production are owned by the state. I don't think so. And then you've got communism, where both, everything is owned by the state, controlled by the state. And there are no communists. It doesn't exist. Okay, China tried. North Korea tried. So anyway, these are accurate economic distinctions. And people misuse these words all the time.
Here's the next question.
I just wanted to get your thoughts on the topic of interventionism. So I'm on board with not having states intervene overseas. But in the past, we used to have a more open mind about allowing individuals to pick sides in international conflicts and go over and support people, such as in the Spanish Civil War.
Sure.
So right now, with the states putting a lot of effort into preventing ISIS from recruiting over here. And then, if the radical Islamic people want to go over and fight it out and get themselves killed, I'm fine with that.
Yeah, sure.
If people want to go over and support the Ukraine on either side, I'm fine with that.
Absolutely. I am totally too. I mean, sure. I mean, really, you ought to support anybody you want and give money to whoever you want. And I think it's great. I mean, sure. I'm all for mercenaries as individuals and mercenary armies, and I think it's great. I mean, not great. I mean, I don't like to see fighting because people get hurt and it's destructive. But, do as thou wilt. Yeah, totally. But it's illegal now. at least for an American citizen, to join a foreign army or something like that and be prosecuted, not just for ISIS.
You made a distinction between healthcare and medical care?
Yes.
I felt compelled to make a bigger distinction between medical care, which is reactive and proactive health maintenance. It was really disturbing. It's not a really disturbing the whole quote-unquote discussion about Obamacare and this really reactive plan. It's as though they have rooms full of nails and their plan is to patch up the tires on a mile-by-mile basis. That's the entire discussion. What really is health maintenance. So that's the only way to get out of the quagmire that we're in, the financial quagmire that we're in.
Yes. No, you're absolutely right. And actually, if we lived in a free market world, which we don't, the price of medical care would have been collapsing the way the price of computers has been collapsing, simply because it is also a high-tech thing. Medical care is very high-tech these days, and its price should be collapsing the way computers have, but it's been going the opposite direction, just like the price of education, not education, that's incorrect. Schooling, I guess, especially on the universal level, has been going up too. So wherever the state sticks its tawdry, dirty fingers, everything is destroyed. So I'm kind of looking forward to the collapse of what's left of Western civilization. But on the other hand, as I always say, you know, if I'd been in France in 1789, I would have cheered, storming the Bastille and bringing down of Louis XVI, except it got worse, because then they got Robespierre and then they got Napoleon and Nicholas II in Russia. I would have cheered that, except then they got Lenin and then they got Stalin. So, you know, after the regime in Washington falls, there's no predicting what's going to happen. I doubt if it's going to be Anartopia or anything like that.
Last question.
Okay.
I'm an anarchist, but if I were king, there would be one law, and that would be every speaker is required to define the main terms they're going to be talking about before they start speaking. Very rare speaker does that, so.
Oh, thank you.
It's a breath of fresh air.
Thank you very much.
And I had the two terms that I thought you might comment on. One is nonprofit. In San Francisco, if you ask someone what they do, about 70% of them will say, I work for a nonprofit. That tells me nothing about what they do. Maybe I'm missing something.
No, you're not.
They think they told me. And then the other one is recycling. If you believe in the second law of thermodynamics, everything is being recycled.
Yeah.
So in the recycling box, I just throw everything.
Thank you. Those are great comments. And I've got to say, the second law of thermodynamics is one of the very few laws I really believe in. And recycling, bicycling, it all comes out of San Francisco. And the other thing, nonprofits, you know, they really are a scam because, you know, people say, oh, a nonprofit, I mean, we just got a bunch of flower children that are, you know, working as interns for free and all that. But what actually happens is that you put the money into the nonprofit, they produce absolutely nothing. And, you know, they employ people. People don't work for nonprofits. They're employed by nonprofits. It's a very passive type of thing. And, you know, a lot of money comes into it, and a lot of money is paid out to the top executives in gigantic salaries, and also in bennies, and lavish parties and all that. So they're really much more egregious than even the worst corporations are. So it's a giant scam, like so much more. But excellent comment. Thank you very much.
name. Been slain. Shut down. Destroyed a turret.
Remember a warmth called hope.
An enemy has been slain. An enemy has been slain.
Order must be enforced.